I got it. Well, thank you so much for that wonderful introduction to the solar system. I should say that a month ago, I think a billion trillion stars fell on the city of Houston. If you look at the amount of rain we got in 4 days, we got actually got a year's worth of rain in 4 days on Saturday, August the 30th. And we're still living through that. So, but I am delighted to be here. And first of all, I need to thank Health Improvement Scotland. Brian, he's listening in, obviously, and Jennifer, where are you, Jennifer? Stand up, please, and take a bow. Jennifer has been instrumental in getting me here and holding my hand and getting me where I needed to be, so, and I don't do anything unless she tells me I'm supposed to do it, so I'm supposed to talk to you now for the next 45 minutes or so. I also like to thank the Glasgow Science Centre. It's very impressive. Obviously, the planetarium is extraordinarily impressive. But it is interesting to know how large the universe is. And we're learning more and more about it as every day. So what I thought I'd do today is, first of all, take you on a little journey, first of all, and show you a short video, a five-minute video, of the last shuttle flight. You heard that there were about 130 shuttle flights. There were actually 135 shuttle flights. The last one was called STS, or Space Transportation-135. The last shuttle flight was very special in that we only flew four astronauts. The reason we only flew four was previous to those flights and after the Columbia accident, we always had another shuttle on the pad ready to go. So if there was a problem with that particular flight, we could launch a rescue flight within days. That last flight, of course, we didn't have that spare shuttle on pad ready to go. So we only flew four in case there was a problem and those four had to stay on board the space station. One of those four, his name is Rex Wallheim. He's now one of my bosses. So he allowed me to show you this video. And it's taken from the crew's perspective. And you will never see anything like this again. Unless you happen to be in the presence of an astronaut. I am not an astronaut, by the way, just to let you know. There are some very specific things that I would point out to you. First of all, you're going to be seeing cockpit video. Then you'll see the shuttle, actually the engine start to light up from close up. The interesting thing about that is that the shuttle engines were actually off axis from the rest of the stack. So when the shuttle engines actually lit up, the entire stack, that means the external tank, the shuttle, and the solid rocket boosters on the side, it's called twang. It moves 6 feet in this direction, and then it, as the twang happens, it comes back, and when it gets back to the vertical, it's actually the point when the solid rocket boosters fire. I think you'll also see how violent the launch is, not just from the back end, but actually if you're riding in the shuttle. So we're going to start that first video, video number one, and I'll try and narrate it for you as we go through. And if we go to full screen as well, that would help.
When a generation accomplishes a great thing, it's got a right to stand back and for just a moment admire and take pride in its work.
Okay, Fergie, we're starting to feel pretty good down here on the ground about this one today. So on behalf of the greatest team in the world, good luck to you and your crew on the final flight of this true American icon. And so for the final time, Fergie, Dub, Sandy, and Rick, good luck, Godspeed, and have a little fun up there.
That's my boss right there, Rex. Lots and lots of people watching the last flight.
Okay.
This is a view from the shuttle cockpit.
This is C-Mac. We verify. Please check.
four crew members are on their own. The closest person around is 3 miles away.
Yes, sir.
Twang. One of the next things you'll see is the inside of the cockpit and how violent the ride actually is. And now the shuttle is detaching from its solid rocket boosters, and then they see the shuttle flying away. Next thing you'll see is the approach of the shuttle to the space station itself. And this is the view from the space station. So there it is. And then they start to do a big backflip in front of the space station to check if there's any damage to the space shuttle on the way up. So it literally does a back somersault, going at 17,500 miles an hour. It's got to be just right and stick the landing. Well, this is sped up, but it's a precision docking. Meals are had with the entire crew together. And there's that robotic arm that was mentioned by the previous speaker. You can move things around in zero gravity that weigh several tons, but they still have mass, so they still have momentum. And then they get to go outside, which is a very special event. Two people going into the vacuum of space. And that's what it looks like from the outside. It's a long way down. And this is why human spaceflight is important. Robots could not do this.
EVA to close this all out as the last of the shuttle EVA. Really appreciate that. A lot of fun, too. Okay, so for all you guys who've worked Expedition 18, I'd like to announce the return of the SAR.
You don't normally lose things in zero gravity. You'll always find them at some point. They get to, about to, after 2 weeks, they get to leave.
Landed the International Space Station for the last
time. Things behave very differently in microgravity too, including fluids and gases, liquids and gases, all fluids, like water. And we launch a few things after we disappear from the station, like CubeSats. Then it's time to come home. And coming back through the atmosphere, and we'll talk more about this, is one of the most dangerous parts of the mission. And there's the landing from the shuttle's point of view. There's the final crew.
I mission complete, Houston. After serving the world for over 30 years, the space shuttle turned its place in history. It's come to a final stop.
All right. So just to give you a taste of what it's like to fly into space, so if we can go back to the PowerPoint presentation on the first slide. You don't need to see who I am. In fact, I'm going to take my badge off so now that you at least know who I am. All right, next chart, please. And the next one. And one more. Okay, so Scotland, I've known Scotland since I was a youngster. In fact, I was born in London. My father was a urologist. My mother was an ophthalmologist. My brother just retired as a general physician. And so Scotland is beautiful from the ground, but it's even more beautiful from space. I spent a lot of my holidays up here in the Highlands, Bror, Dornoch, and Helmsdale. Then I went all the way to the Outer Hebrides, out to the South Uist. So I know Scotland very well, and it's a place that I love coming back to. Is there any way we can turn the house lights down a little bit to make it a little darker? Okay, thank you. Any way we can turn them down a little bit more to make it a little darker? Okay, well, we'll try. All right, let's put things in perspective. That's even better, thank you. I come from Texas. Texas is one of the 50 states of the United States. It has a landmass acreage 9 times that of Scotland. All right, so you can fit Scotland into my state 9 times. It's a big place, and it's a very flat place and a very boring place in most cases. Scotland has a lot more to offer from scenery, I will tell you that. The debris from the Columbia accident, which is what we're going to talk about this evening in part, was 400 miles long by 10 miles wide. How do I put that in perspective? It's from Glasgow to Eastbourne, where my mother lives. So the debris field when Columbia broke apart in February of 2003 covered that stretch. 400 miles long, 10 miles wide. You can imagine how long it took to search that debris field to find every piece of debris. And to date, we've only found about 35, 37% of the shuttle. The rest of it's still out there. Just doesn't mean it's out. All right, so the question I'm often asked when I go around the world telling the Columbia story is human spaceflight safe? Is it safe? I compare it to oil and gas. So this is the Deepwater Horizon, which back in 2010 exploded in the Gulf of Mexico, resulting in the loss of 11 crew members. Of course, this is Shuttle Columbia, 2003, disintegrated upon entry, losing 7 crew members. We'll talk about who they were in a little bit. Same thing for commercial aviation. We take it for granted when we get on a commercial airplane that it's safe, right? Well, things happen. So we're not as human beings weren't meant to fly. In other words, they've given us wings. Bad things do happen. And in fact, back in 1989, this is United Airlines Flight 232. It's a fairly famous one in the United States because all of the engines in the CC-10 were taken out by actually, interestingly, the same fault that created the destruction of the Space Shuttle Columbia back in 2003. This particular flight, there were 185 people survived, 111 people passed away. But again, they keep asking us, is it safe? Go to the next one, Bhopal, India. You're probably a bit closer to home, to at least to Europe. An estimated 25,000 fatalities when 40 tons of methyl isocyanate were released into the atmosphere. I say estimated because we don't know today what the total death toll was there. Same thing, is it safe? So I ask you the question, is our medical profession and the techniques and the procedures that we follow, are they safe? Well, let's paint a real life scenario for you. In my world, and this is a real life scenario, let's say that I have a critical circulation pump which I'm depending on in this thermal control system, and it's malfunctioning. I'm required to deliver 1.5 liters per minute at 950 millimeters of mercury. It's actually delivering only 3/4 of a liter a minute at 175 millimeters of mercury. The thermal control systems engineer therefore asks himself or herself several questions. how long has it been going on? What's the history? The answer is a gradual decline over several months. What does the real-time X-ray show? It shows that there's a potential leakage around the inlet and outlet valves to this pump. So what is the effect on the downstream systems of this pump's low performance? So the lower cooling capacity in the system means that we could reach a critical point in 6 months at the present rate of decay and shutting down of the life support systems, meaning we would have to evacuate the space station. Real life example. So what's the path forward? So what I would ask myself, what are the options? I could remove and I could replace the pump. But however, the pump's no longer manufactured and it's going to take 12 months and $5 million to make a new one. That's one option. I could remove and replace the valve seals themselves. That assumes that the seal integrity is actually the contributing factor. And the fact that, do I have an astronaut who's readily trained on how to do this procedure in zero gravity? Do nothing to the pump. I've got another way of cooling my life support system. Until a replacement pump can be manufactured and sent up. There is a secondary cooling system available on orbit. It's a relatively simple operation. There's an astronaut on orbit that has experience with this pump, and I can provide just-in-time training for this crew member to change that pump out. Or I could do nothing. I've already exceeded the useful life of the space station. I could evacuate the space station and terminate the program. All of these have both risk versus risk traits, right? So by taking the original pump out, building a new one, relying on a secondary system has a risk, right? I'm putting in a secondary system that really wasn't designed to do that job. But all of these are risk versus risk traits. So let's look at your profession. What about the medical event? And I am not a physician. I am not a doctor. My doctorate is a PhD. But you are. So I'll let you fill in some of these blanks. But you see, I've highlighted certain things. I'm going to give you a scenario. An 82-year-old patient, right, not a thermal control system, but a patient, presents with symptoms of circulatory problems. They're hypertensive. So the physician asks several questions. How long has it been going on? What's the patient's history? Not the pump's history. What's the patient's history? What other symptoms are associated with a potential diagnosis? What diagnostic tools are available to me as a diagnosing physician? Do I have ECG? Do I have angiography available that can tell me what's going wrong with this patient? And then you, as the diagnosing physician, you have the path forward of providing those options to the patient or to your medical team. Your options A, B, and C may be all the way from a very drastic event all the way to option D, which is I'm saying here, do nothing, right? The patient is 82 years old. There is more of a risk to put this individual under general anesthesia than there is the benefit of them actually having prolonged life. Is it better to allow this person to pass away in 6 months rather than giving them 8 months of extended lifetime? But again, these are all risk versus risk trade. So we are in a common business. We're trading risk for risk. All right. Next chart. So is it safe? Is that really the right question? Do you really think that strapping yourself into the seat of a shuttle with 7 million pounds of thrust on it that you can't get off of for 2.5 minutes is something that a sane person would do if they thought it was safe? It's absolutely the wrong question. The right question is it safe enough, right? Everything that we do in human spaceflight has a risk to it. But the management of that risk is the key. You have to know what the risk is, first of all, identify what's causing it, what's the likelihood that that risk will show itself up and manifest itself in something bad, and what's the consequence if that risk comes to be. And then you mitigate those risks wherever you can, and accept the residual risk. There's always going to be some risk involved. So at some point, you have to say, we're having to accept that residual risk. But the question is, who accepts it? In your world, I believe it should be the patient, right? That patient is the person that is taking the absolute risk with their life in many cases. And the same thing here for our astronauts. They are the ones accepting the risk. So another example, the shuttle risk. At the time of the first shuttle flight in 1981, when John Young and Bob Crippen were the first two astronauts to fly into space on the shuttle, the risk of losing the crew on that particular flight was estimated at between 1 in 1,000 and 1 in 10,000. Pretty good odds, actually. Those were based on the tools that we had available at the time. And graphically, I can show you that the probability of losing that crew back in STS-1, the first flight, was 1 in 1,000 to 1 in 10,000. It was called the Wiggins analysis because of the person that did it. But at the completion of the shuttle program in 2011, and using the tools that we had, after 135 flights, the risk of losing that crew on that first flight was actually 1 in 12. Even John Young, who had walked on the moon, I think would have puckered a little bit with those odds of coming home or not with 1 in 12. So it demonstrates, however, that your understanding of the overall risk depends upon the tools and the data that you have available at the time. And as technology improves, your understanding of how to manage risk improves over time. So I've got a quiz for you. So here we go. How many fatalities in human spaceflight history have there been? I'm giving it to you. It's a multiple choice question. So think about one of these answers and keep that in your mind. All right? I'm going to give you the answers, so don't worry. So this is Apollo 1. To me, it's called Apollo Soyuz, AS-204. Three people perished in Apollo 1, 1961. This is Challenger, 7 there. And this is Columbia, so another 7. So how many people said 17? Only one? Okay. The rest of you are either very, very intelligent or you've heard my talk before. And I know you haven't heard my talk before, so that by definition means you're intelligent. If you remember, if I go back to the question again, in human spaceflight history have there been? I did not say U.S. human spaceflight. So this is Soyuz 1. One person in this capsule whose name is Komarov. He flew back in 1961, and his Soyuz capsule had a malfunction on orbit. They knew that his parachutes were not going to open. They told him that before he re-entered, so he knew he was going to perish. They brought his wife in to talk to him in mission control, and he impacted the ground on the steps of Russia, and he was obviously lost in that accident. So that's Soyuz 1. And this is Soyuz 11, back in 1967. This is very reminiscent, and I'll show you a picture of a recent Soyuz landing. Again, it's the steps of Russia. So this is the capsule. This is the part of the vehicle that returns. The crew here on the ground is opening the hatch, and this is the actual photograph from that accident. Normally, they would open the hatch, lean in, greet their cosmonaut friends, and they would pull them out and celebrate with vodka. Right. That was the normal event. In this particular case, when they opened the hatch, they found 3 dead cosmonauts. The cabin itself had depressurized on entry, and the crew who was not wearing the spacesuits perished because of the depressurization. So interestingly, though, if you look at what happened in 2008, so we've had these Soyuz vehicles landing with U.S. astronauts and Russian astronauts ever since 2003, the very similar pictures, if you think about it, the shape of the Soyuz spacecraft is exactly the same. They have not changed the shape of the spacecraft at all. There's the hatch. It's on its side, which is a normal way that it actually lands. But take a look in the background. This is the helicopter back in 1967. This is the helicopter in 2008. It's the same helicopter. some 40 years later. Shows you how much the Soviets held on to their technology. But it's exactly the same helicopter. But in this case, they pull them out and they were alive. So the answer should have been 21. How many people said 21? Okay, good. All right. If those were the only events in human spaceflight history that had had the potential to cause harm to a crew or cause fatalities, we would be very much mistaken. Jennifer, did we hand out those little cards to each of them? Okay, so you each have this in your little packet. So we collected all of the events in human spaceflight history, and I'm not going to go through these because you have it yourself, but just to orient you here, this is by flight phase. So here's the launch, here's the ascent, here's Earth orbit, for missions that went out to the moon, down to the surface of the moon, back up from the surface of the moon, back down to Earth orbit, and entry, descent, and landing. So each of these events that are around here now correspond to these flight phases. So you can look at these number of events and you say, we got lucky, and we did. But we are now telling the world about these events. So this is in the public domain. All of this data is in the public domain. And so our Russian colleagues, our Chinese colleagues, our Indian colleagues, all spacefaring nations have this data. So sharing of when bad things happen, or even when bad things could have happened, is vital. Because back in 1961, and on the back of your little pamphlet, you will find a story about we could have avoided Apollo 1. So read that at your leisure. All right. I'm going to transition now into Columbia. This story about Columbia has been told now to over, I've given this presentation to over 30,000 people. And I tell it because the people that need to know hear what went wrong. Because only then can they make decisions on whether to fix their problems or not. So I'm going to be showing you a few videos today. There's nothing graphic. I can guarantee you there's no photographs. But there are some simulations. I will warn you, just like our hosts at the Science Center did, if you are prone to motion sickness, just close your eyes if you get sick. And then I'll tell you when to open them again. So I'm going to give you a disclaimer right off the bat. My extended experience and involvement with this investigation, I'm comfortable giving this presentation because I treat it as an engineering mishap. All right. I will tell you that the Columbia crew, every one of them, all seven of them, were very good friends of mine. The six Americans and one Israeli. I was a test subject for that crew for over 3 years. So they stuck me with things in places that I don't want to even recall. But they were very good friends of mine. But in order to understand the ramifications of what we learned, you have to treat it as an engineering mishap rather than anything else. So the purpose of this briefing for those folks was to summarize the investigation activities. What did we find out? What did we recommend? How those recommendations were at the time being addressed by the shuttle. The shuttle program is now ended. By future spacecraft such as the Orion spacecraft. And here is the 444-page presentation report that I co-authored with my colleagues, which was co-authored back in 2008, released just before New Year's. Publicly available for a reason. So we're going to go through things, some methods, the background, the accident timeline itself, and a couple of the key findings. I'm not going to bore you with things that aren't related to you, but there are some things that are important you should hear. So the background. STS-107 was the 113th flight in the shuttle program. It was the 28th flight of orbital vehicle 102, which was given the call sign Columbia. It was a 16-day science mission, which launched on January the 16th of 2003. At 81.7 seconds into the flight, a piece of foam shed or fell off of the external tank and struck the left wing of the space shuttle Columbia, creating a very large hole. We, as an agency, didn't believe that the damage could have been that great. And if people have questions later on, I can certainly tell you why we fooled ourselves into thinking that it was not a problem. The shuttle on the February the 1st, 2003, deorbited and reached the entry interface, which is the point where the shuttle experienced the first parts of the shuttle of the Earth's atmosphere, which is defined as 400,000 feet in altitude and going 24 and a half times the speed of sound. That occurred at about 1:45 Greenwich Mean Time. All of our times from here on out will be GMT. We use Greenwich Mean Time as our universal time. The planned touchdown at Kennedy Space Center was for 2:15 in the afternoon that same day. It was a beautiful, sunny Saturday morning, as it was when it launched. I will tell you that when it launched, it was a science mission. There were no plans for it to go anywhere close to the space station. It could not physically have gone to the space station. It didn't have enough fuel to get there. It was in the wrong orbit. So people said, why didn't you just send it to the space station and take safe haven on board the space station? It could never have got there. Period. All right. When the accident happened, a presidential investigation was launched, and the CABE, or the Columbia Accident Investigation Board, was formed the next day. How quickly could it? People ask how come it could be done so quickly? The board had already been named before the accident. We always have an investigatory board named just in case there is an accident. So the board formed was in 2003. As part of that accident investigation board, a crew survival working group was formed. That they were tasked to come out what happened to the crew and the crew module. They ran out of money. We could not support the CABE. So, in fact, a separate team, there was one recommendation from the CABE, which was published. There's the recommendation. Said future vehicles should be designed such that if there were another accident, we maximize the ability of the crew to survive. That was all they said. Subsequent to that, though, we formed a new team, the Spacecraft Crew Survival Integrated Investigation Team, in October 2004, and that was the team that I led. And our purpose was to form a multidisciplinary team, including the engineering side of the house, the life sciences, the crew equipment training and everyone, which included the autopsy and the findings from autopsies in terms of what happened to the crew. How could we maximize the survivability of this crew in future accidents? Develop that lessons learned for investigations and to write that report, which I just showed you earlier on. I've got to give you a little bit about shuttle anatomy. Each of the shuttles was the same basic and had the same basic anatomy, but it was really built in three parts. This part in the front here, which is where the crew lived in the pressurized volume here. Then there was the mid-body, as it's called, which is the payload bay, which is where we put our payloads. And then a part called the aft body, which is where the engines were and all the mechanicals. So these three pieces were fabricated separately, were joined together, and that becomes important when we actually look at how the vehicles came apart. So how do we attack this from using what methods do we have to attack this problem? So we need to look at accelerations, we need to look at the thermal environment, the atmospheric aspects, and you had to put all of the data that we had together, including videos. You'll see the videos became very, very important. The debris that was actually recovered, we had some data from the vehicle, the telemetry from the vehicle, the medical data that we had from the crew, and models and simulations. So video was helpful in that it anchored key events. I will show you here that these are three frames captured within a 30th of a second of each other. So within a 30th of a second, the video show went from this to this to this. And we did not change the magnification. We didn't change the lighting. So even if you didn't know what happened between here, here, and here, you know that something happened, right? Because it's a completely different appearance of the main part of the shuttle. So it anchored key events such as the breakup of the vehicle. Debris, very, very complicated. And I'll show you that because these three pieces of debris that were recovered in the field were put together on a grid, which is what accident investigators do. So these three pieces were put together on a grid where they would have been in the intact vehicle. Well, this piece looks almost pristine. The white paint is still on the aluminum frame. Sorry, aluminium frame. I need to remember that. This piece over here is down to the primer, which is the primer of the paint. And this piece right next to it, and the scale here is about a foot, this piece right next to it is completely eroded thermally. Right? It has basically been melted away. So if you base your analysis and your conclusions on this piece of debris without taking into account this piece right next to it, you will come to a very different conclusion. So it's really human pathology of the forensics of the vehicle itself, not the people, but the vehicle itself. A lot of the tools that we use were based upon ballistics, so much so that the only appendix in the report is a tutorial on ballistics. Do we have any people that are marksmen here or hunters or rifle shooters? Okay, well, that's good. In essence, though, if you impart the same amount of energy into something that is much, much heavier with a thinner cross-section than something that is lighter and has a flat cross-section, they will end up in different places. Right? That basically is what ballistics will say. So that same piece of debris that came from that previous slide, compare this, which is about maybe a kilogram in mass, maybe about 50 centimeters by 75 centimeters. These are the power heads of the engine. There are three of them. This is a person standing. That's their leg. These weigh about 3 tons. And going at the speed that they were going, they embedded themselves in the earth by about 15 feet, each of them. They landed in a different state. So ballistics, knowing what the mass of this is, are important because you can tell when it was liberated from the intact shuttle. The biggest problem, though, is ballistics doesn't account for cascading failures. So if this part keeps getting eroded and eroded, if you use ballistic equations on this piece of hardware, it wasn't the way it was when it was released from the vehicle. So ballistics can also lead you down the wrong pathway. Models were interesting, but the problem was I showed you that the shuttle comes in three pieces. We have a very good aerodynamic model of the intact shuttle, but when the forebody of the shuttle separated, which it did, and I'll show you that, we didn't have a model of just the forebody where the crew was living, so that we couldn't use the models that we had without a lot of unknowns. Also, things happened very differently going at Mach 18 in a monatomic oxygen environment. I will tell you that titanium actually combusts. It doesn't melt. It combusts at those temperatures. So actually, I can tell you I will let you know that when the remains were recovered, they were covered with a very fine mist of titanium, which is in some ways very fitting, actually. Some cases we couldn't tell you exactly when things happened. We could bound the cases. So we could tell you that the depressurization of the shuttle happened, initiated no earlier than something or no later than something, and ended no earlier or no later. So we could bound things by certain events and certain pieces of evidence. So that really is what I'm pointing to down here, the boundary driven. Things that were very difficult for us. Materials were in a very high temperature environment, very low pressure, monatomic oxygen, which is highly reactive compared to diatomic molecular oxygen. Hypersonic separation, nothing had come apart at these speeds before. The suits that the crew members were wearing failed So the questions we had to ask is, why did they fail and how did they fail? The crew were actually separated from their seats. Again, how did that happen? Some other things like shockwave impingement. If there's a shockwave impinging on another shockwave, you can get temperatures reaching vastly higher than you could ever predict. And the last thing, which I can't take away, I can't leave you by saying something about, is that these were our friends. And so we were actually analyzing literally the last seconds of our friend's life. So it was emotionally difficult to do that. So we're going to take you to the timeline, and this is where some of the more interesting stuff starts. So quarter till 2 in the afternoon on February the 1st, as I said, the shuttle reached entry interface at Mach 24.5, 400,000 feet. About 14 minutes later, the first error message came on board that said, our left inboard tire pressure reading has gone off scale low. Now, you saw a quick shot of mission control. This message was received in mission control as well. So the operator that has responsibility for that system had seen this, right? He was sitting there and he had to first of all wonder what's going on. Then he relayed to the flight director, who's the person who's in charge of that flight control room, and said, flight, we have an interesting piece of data, off scale low on our inboard left inboard tire pressure. So the flight director is thinking about that, so he receives that information, he's thinking about it, and he asks the question back to the systems operator, and he said, what do you mean they've gone off scale low? So what I'm trying to get here is that all of this is happening in a matter of seconds, but traveling at 24.5 times the speed of sound, things happen very, very quickly. So even though the team on the ground was trying to analyze what was going wrong, they were evolving and happening as they were having these conversations. So this was the first indication that something was wrong. About 12 seconds, well, a minute, 12 seconds later, we lost signal from the shuttle. That means we lost all of our real-time telemetry from the shuttle, any data coming down from the shuttle, any voice coming down from the shuttle. In fact, that was the last time we had heard from the crew, was that 1358-40 mark. We never heard from them again. So I say lots of real-time telemetry data in mission control in Houston, but there is data that comes down, all of the data comes down to a location in New Mexico called White Sands, New Mexico, which is a missile range. That data is analyzed real-time. This happens in microseconds. It's filtered, and if it doesn't meet the strict requirements for data quality, it is not sent forward to Houston. Again, this happens in microseconds. But that data is still captured in White Sands, New Mexico, so it's still recorded. So we had two blips of that data, and we'll talk about that. Here's the first one. The first blip of data is 5 seconds long, and we call it the RGPC1. Now, you'll know that NASA is big into acronyms. Sometimes we can say an entire sentence without a verb. But this 5-second piece of RGPC1 data indicated at that time that everything was okay. All of our systems were nominal. However, we have some jets on the back of the shuttle that because you're not in the atmosphere yet, they're called reaction control system jets. They actually are like rockets. So the shuttle at this point was continuing to try and control itself. The commander and pilot of the shuttle are not controlling the entry of the space shuttle. They're not flying the space shuttle. It's too complex a task for a human to actually take over and fly. So the computer was telling the shuttle, I need to fire these your jets at the back of the shuttle to maintain where I'm trying to get to, right, which is Kennedy Space Center in Florida. At 5 seconds at the end of that period, we started to get into a period of loss of control. And the crew on board received this roll reference alarm at 1359.46. The data from that 2-second blip of data, said that the dynamics of the vehicle was certainly within human tolerance, probably no injuries. It was probably disorientating even, because this crew had been in zero gravity for 16 days. So the first gravity field that they were actually getting used to at this point was not normal. So they were probably disoriented, but certainly no injuries at this particular point in time. So here it is. These are a snapshot from these models. This is a 10-second interval, so these are 1-second intervals. So here it is in control at 1359.37. 10 seconds later, the shuttle is a ballistic missile coming to the Earth's atmosphere, completely out of control. So in the space of 10 seconds, we went from in control to out of control. Now I'm going to show you a couple of videos. The first one is going to be video 2 for the folks at the back. And that is going to show you what we believe from the data that we have with actually the movement of the vehicle. So this red line here is the direction of travel. And this is what we believe the shuttle actually did. It's at about 180,000 feet. Do I have any pilots in the room? Okay. This is not normal, just to let you know. All right. Go back to the presentation, if you would just close that one out. And back to the presentation. So the second video I'm going to show you, if you were the commander of the space shuttle at that particular point, looking and either in the left-hand seat on the flight deck, the windows that they have, I'm going to show you what the commander would have seen, and I will tell you exactly when he knew that they were not going to make it home. So if we can run video 3. The answer is now. So this is what he would have been seeing out the front window. And you see we're about 200,000 feet. If you have motion sickness, close your eyes. Okay, and close that out. And go back to the PowerPoint again. Okay, next shot. Can you go to the next shot? Oh, I can do that, can't I? Sorry. So you might say, well, what were the crew experiencing at that time? So based on the motion of the shuttle at the time, in the three axes we were talking about, X, Y, and Z, didn't say Z, thank you, but Z, all right. So these are the G amount, G loads. G is zero is sitting in your seat. 3.5 is actually forcing you down into your seat. All right. Y is left to right, and X is forward to back. So you can see that in most cases, these are cyclic. They have an amplitude that is somewhat increasing, but these are not debilitating. Look at the absolute values here. 1G positive to about 3/4 of a G negative in Y, gradually increasing in Z from about 0.75 all the way up to 2.5 G, 3 G. Your seatbelt in your car doesn't lock until you hit 3.5 G. So if you were wearing a seatbelt on the shuttle, it would not have locked. And in fact, the same seatbelt design on the shuttle did not lock. Which created a large number of the injuries that we saw in the remains that were recovered. So it's not that bad of an environment. So people have asked me, did the crew try and regain control of the shuttle? Did they try and take manual control to save themselves? And the answer is yes, without hope, by the way. This second set of blip of data, which is the 2 seconds long, that data indicated the cabin parameters, the pressure, the temperature was still good. our auxiliary power units, which creates electricity to run our systems, to especially the flight control systems, the ailerons, the elevons, the rudder, they were running, but the hydraulic pressures in the system and the quantities were both at zero. And the reason for that is because the hole in the left wing, as the shuttle was coming in through the atmosphere, hot gases entered the hole in the left wing and took out all three of the hydraulic systems that were co-located in the body of the shuttle. So it lost all hydraulic power. All right, so even though the crew, even though the auxiliary power units were still running, there was no hope of getting any hydraulic pressure. So if you go, I think you can click on this one. No, you can't. That's the next page. I'm sorry, next page. It's me. So this is a piece of debris that was recovered in the field in East Texas. This is panel R2, which is on the right-hand side of the shuttle flight deck and the pilot's right-hand side. The important reason for this piece of debris is that this is how it was found in the field. It was folded over on itself. Why is that important? Well, curiosity kills the cat, as they say. So we wanted to make sure that there was no attempt to maneuver any of these switches that were inside this fold, because they were important switches for us. Because when we finally unfolded them, we found evidence that the switches were left in these positions by the crew. These are locking switches, so you actually have to pull them out, move them, and let them go, and they will lock again. So these switches were in a position that the crew left them in. What they indicated to us was that the pilot was trying, there are three auxiliary power units on board the shuttle. He had turned two of them off to try and restart them. He had left one in operation, which is great systems thinking. You never turn all three of your auxiliary power units off. And he was trying to restart the other two. Similarly, he was trying to get hydraulic pressure in his systems by the fact that he had turned the hydraulic circulation pumps for hydraulic systems 2 and 3 on. So yes, the pilot was rational enough in the short time that he had consciousness to try and recover control of the shuttle. To no avail. He never could have. All right. At 15 seconds after that, the main vehicle started to break up. We call it the catastrophic event. It's based on video that we saw from the ground, and we had one recorder that was on board the shuttle that lost power. So when the vehicle actually broke up into three pieces, the power plant, which was in the back end, stopped producing power for the electrical systems in the front. So we know when this experimental recorder lost power, we know exactly when the vehicle started to come apart. I'm not going to go through this part exactly how it happened, but the next chart will show you that when it happened, the forebody of the shuttle, which is this part, so again, this is where the crew is, the pressurized module here. This is the payload bay back in here. The two pieces are joined by what are called X-links and Y-links, basically struts that hold the two pieces together. Because of the motion of the shuttle, what happened was the nose of the shuttle pitched down violently and yawed left, which means a very rapid move left and down. So essentially it tore itself off of the remainder of the shuttle. And we'll share that with you in a second. When that happened, though, everything in this front part essentially moved forward. So here's the pressurized volume right here, where the crew actually was residing. And things started to shift. As soon as that violent pitch down and yaw to the left happened, the crew module shifted forward, impacting some of the struts on the floor. And that poked a big old hole in the bottom of the floor. So we're going to start talking about lethal events and potentially lethal events in a minute. The first one was depressurization of the cabin. I told you that we got this on video too. So the next video, which I believe is video 4, is that right? Yes. Can you pause this for a second? Thank you. Okay. So we had three videos available to us. One was from a town in Texas called Hewitt, Texas. One was another town in Texas called Mesquite. And the NBC Broadcasting Company was actually filming it. They knew what path it was coming in on that Saturday morning. So they were actually out there as a professional photographer. These two videos were just shot by amateur photographers who volunteered their videos once a call went out to the community saying, does anyone have any videos or still photography of the shuttle? The important thing about these three sources is they were at different locations. So this was the NBC video angle, this was the Mesquite, Texas angle, and this was the Hewitt, Texas angle. What that let us do was perform video triangulation. So we can analyze these three videos and know exactly how, what the shuttle was doing at the time. So I'm going to let this run. On the top is a simulation showing what is happening. And I will call out to you when you will see this catastrophic event, when the forebody of the shuttle separated from the rest of the shuttle. Okay, so let's let it run. So this, to all intents and purposes, for most people, especially something with this size, it looked very normal. But from the NBC video, obviously not. So the shuttle is still relatively intact. But you will see a change in the contrail, and I'll tell you when that's coming up. It's coming up right there. Did you see a flash? Okay, you can stop this one. What we did was, because that was very jerky, we took the two videos, which were the Hewitt and the Mesquite videos, and go to the video 5, I believe. And you can pause this one when you start too. Okay. All right, so this is the Mesquite video and the Hewitt video side by side. Now what we've done is we've stabilized the videos, frame stabilized them. So forget about the background moving around. What you're now seeing is we're keeping the main part of the shuttle in the main part of the field. This analysis is very difficult to do. So it's very short, and so the catastrophic event comes up much, much quicker in this particular case. So we're going to run it, and I'll point it out. We may have to run it twice. So run it now if you could. There. Do you see it? Let's go back and play that again right from the beginning. Okay, so it's there. See that big puff? Literally, that was when the front part of the shuttle separated from the rest of the vehicle. And as we follow it on down, you'll see, and I'm going to show you a different video in a second, but essentially this is the crew module part up here, and you can tell also about that time it had just basically disappeared. All right. So you can close this one out. Now, just per chance, there was an Apache helicopter out of one of the Army bases, Fort Bragg, that was up in the air that day and had forward-looking infrared photography on its nose camera. So next shot. Go to the next. Oh, I got it. I keep forgetting. Okay, before we get there, medical evidence that we have from the autopsy indicated the cabin pressure condition at the catastrophic event was within the bounds of human survival. That means that the depressurization event could not have started any earlier than this time, 14:00:18 seconds. So the cabin depress started no later than this time, based on the ballistics on the patch. So our first lethal event was this cabin depressurization. The crew became unconscious in 6 to 8 seconds. Again, if you don't have any pilots here, there's a term called the time of useful consciousness, which is much less than losing consciousness. So if you lose consciousness in 8 seconds, the time of useful consciousness is about 2 seconds. So from the time of the breach of the hull of Columbia to the time where the crew actually became fully unconscious was 8 seconds. After that time, the crew was completely unaware of everything else that happened. All right, it's important to note for every audience and especially for the younger members of the audience, that once the crew lost consciousness, basically they went to sleep, they never woke up, ever. So everything else that happened after this time, the crew knew nothing about. All right. So the next thing that happened is, of course, now this crew module with the crew inside, unconscious crew inside, also broke up. It was not meant to withstand the reentry forces. So it actually broke up also. Now, we caught that on video. I don't need to show you that. The cabin depressed was based on the video that we found. So the depress was complete in no more than 24 seconds. So we can bound that event at least in 24 seconds. Total dispersal is when we no longer recognize the pieces of debris that we're seeing. And here's the video I'm going to show you, which is a video from that Apache helicopter that happened to be in the area. So if we can start that. And it's black and white because it's an infrared photograph. We can go to, there you go. All right, so here we are again. So here's the vehicle breaking up. Now, right here is the crew module. And as you can see, it's shedding. It'll go out of frame, and it'll come back in frame. And it's shedding debris as it's going along. Again, it'll come back in frame right up here. And finally, the last signature from there. Now, these pieces right here are the three engine powerheads, which ended up, and you'll see the tree line coming up in a minute. Those powerheads ended up on an Army golf course in Louisiana. So it actually crossed the state line into Louisiana. So here are the second through the fifth lethal event. So the second lethal event, potentially lethal event, with an unconscious crew, remember, was exposure to this dynamic rotating environment. The helmets that they were wearing were not like normal motorcycle helmets in that they had no padding on the inside, so they were non-conformal. A lack of upper body restraint, so there was no seat belt holding them in place, and so the head itself was able to move around with inside the helmet. The third event was separation from the crew module itself and the seat, interaction with the rest of the material field, the debris field, and the very hot consequences. At about 140,000 feet, exposure to a near vacuum, aerodynamic accelerations, and the cold temperatures. And the fifth lethal event is obviously ground impact. So my job now is to look at these potentially lethal events and say, could we have protected the crew from any one of these? All right? Or if I couldn't, could I do so in the future? So the first lethal event, which is the cabin depress, unconsciousness in 6 to 8 seconds. Absolutely survivable, even with the suits they were wearing that day. Or were they? One of the findings is that the crew never completed donning of their spacesuits, their full pressure suits. There's a reason for that, which is that the time of entry into the Earth's atmosphere is one of the busiest times, and very few crews actually are ready to enter Earth's atmosphere, fully suited, fully ready to go. So if the cabin depressed their pressure suits, if they had been worn properly, would have saved them from that particular event. The second one, though, is exposure to that dynamic rotating environment, non-conformal helmets, lack of upper body restraint. Formula One cars regularly plow into very solid pieces of wall going at 200 miles an hour. And those drivers get out and they walk away. So absolutely, those are survivable with current technology. They were not, because our straps that we strapped them in with, which first of all didn't lock, were about half an inch wide. If you look at the bolsters and the protective devices that Formula One drivers wear today, you can understand, and the cocoon that they're in, you can understand why they are able to get up and walk away from absolutely horrific accidents. Third lethal event, separation from the crew module and the seat, material interactions, thermal consequences. That was the one event out of the five that there was no technology back in 2008, 2009, even today, I believe, that could protect a crew member from that type of environment. Fourth lethal event, the exposure to near vacuum, aerodynamic accelerations, cold environments. I put survival with a question mark. If the suit were worn properly and if it remained intact, it was certified to withstand conditions at 100,000 feet. This happened at 104,000, 140,000 feet. So who knows? Maybe it could. And the fifth lethal event was ground impact, which was absolutely survivable. They were wearing parachutes. The problem is that the crew had to be conscious to eject themselves from the shuttle to activate their parachutes. Absolutely survivable with current, even with the current shuttle crew escape pilot. So I'm going to show you a couple of key findings. The crew members, as I mentioned, did not complete putting their gloves on. One didn't complete putting their helmet on or strapping themselves into the seat. It's such a very busy time that we force the crew members to finish the deorbit preparation before they can take their seats, even though that's the most dangerous, now we know, one of the most dangerous phases of flight. What we came up with in terms of recommendations were that future spacecraft should be designed such that the equipment and procedures provided to protect the crew themselves are compatible with the nominal operation. I'm not going to walk all the way through this for you. None of the crew members lowered and locked their visors. The space suits have a helmet on which has a visor which can go up and down. Only when the visor is down does flow become initiated, oxygen flow become initiated to the helmet. But you would have thought that the first thing the crew would have done would have lowered their visors to initiate oxygen flow. None of them did. There's probably potential reasons why. First of all, it was dark, because once they lost power, all the lights went out. It was dark, they didn't have any communication systems. They may have had to rely on each other, hearing each other, and when you go visor down, you would not be able to hear anyone else. It would be very, very simple that if you lost pressure to the spacecraft, a simple pressure monitoring sensor could have closed those visors automatically. Okay? So you would not have to rely upon manual control, manual activity to save yourself. I'm going to point to the investigation process itself. This was my second job. All right? This happened in the evenings. This happened on weekends. This happened on holidays. Every member of the team, this was their second job. So we were exchanging emails regularly, 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning. We would be having technical discussions by email at 3 o'clock in the morning, saying, I think it's probable that this happened. Another person will come back and say, no, it didn't happen that way because of this. This was our second job. In other words, we were so intent on reflying the next space shuttle that we didn't have the time to do this thorough investigation unless you did it after hours, on weekends, and on your holidays. One of the team members on my team was the commander of the second space shuttle to fly. So she was doing this up to 2 weeks before she actually flew. And I told her eventually, I said, Pam, stop. Put your computer down and go fly the shuttle. She was the commander of the shuttle. But she was so intent on finding out and getting this message out to the rest of the community that she wanted to do this almost up to the time when she flew. So I'm going to go to the next page, and I'll let you read it. And then it'll transition to the final slide, and then we'll open up questions for you. you can bring the house lights up, if you would. So this is always a difficult presentation for me to give, but it's one of hope for me. And the hope is that the people that hear it will tell this story. If they understand it, will spread the word. It may not be absolutely applicable to your everyday job. However, the similarities in what we did here in terms of understanding the risks, getting rid of threats to the individuals that take this risk and fly in space and a place where we shouldn't be, right? By all means, we have to wear spacesuits to go outside. We shouldn't be in space. But we go there because we want to explore. But the risk, understanding the risk, mitigating those risks, minimizing the risk is, I would tell you, part of your everyday job as it is mine, to your patients. For me, I owe it to the next generation of people that are going to climb into the next spacecraft because I don't want them to end up in the same situation that the Columbia crew ended up, my friends ended up. So that's why I have the passion that I do about going around the world telling the story. I hope you understand a little bit of my passion. Hopefully you understand a little bit more about human spaceflight and the risks involved in human spaceflight and bring them from space down to Earth. So thank you very much for your time.
Nigel, thank you very, very much. That was really, really touching at the end and an absolute tribute to your friends. I couldn't say enough about it. For me, there was lots of that. I'm Anne Gow. I'm a nurse director at Healthcare Improvement Scotland and have, over my career, done many adverse event reviews, and some of the people I've done reviews with indeed are in this room. And lots of similarities and lots of learning, I think, in terms of your process and our process. Certainly looking at risk, thinking about safety, actually thinking in advance about our risks, making sure we've got teams set up properly who are well prepared, who are emotionally prepared as well as technically prepared to deal with some very difficult subject matter expertise, and to be able to go through that level of detail, I think, to get the learning. The only bit, I think, of your talk that I didn't recognise was this thing about wearing pants for a month to do an experiment. And I'm just kind of hoping that it's the American version of pants and not the British version of pants, because that's a whole new level.
No,
of
it was the Japanese version of pants, I have to tell you. It was actually underwear, and they worked. the Japanese do things in strange ways, but no, it was underwear.
Some of the younger members of our audience might appreciate that one, I think. We've got some time now for questions, and I wonder, just talking to the younger members of the audience, I wonder if some of the young astronauts might want to ask some questions first.
And there's somebody with a microphone right over there. So if you've got a question, why don't you wait for the microphone to show up and ask your question. I'm sure the youngsters in the audience, the young men and women who maybe one day will fly the next version of this, might have a question. Callum, do you have one? Olivia? No? Okay.
No.
Okay. All right. What about the less young people in the audience? The grown-ups. Have any questions?
Gregor.
Microphone coming.
First thing to say, Nigel, is thank you. What a wonderfully sensitive presentation you've given us. And it's on that theme that I just want to dwell for a wee second, because one of the things I've always been struck by when asking people to conduct some sort of significant event review is actually the toll that it sometimes takes on individuals who are investigating. And you've spoken with great sensitivity, actually, about how these were your friends. Can you say a little bit about the NASA approach or your approach as to how you developed the resilience to be able to go through such a difficult review in such detail?
Well, I think it really goes to a disclaimer I had at the beginning, which is you have to look at it from an engineering perspective, right? If you let emotions get in the way about what did the crew do, what did the crew not do, what did the crew feel, then you're never going to come to the answer that can help anyone, right? Emotional impacts really don't help anyone design things in a better way. You can do the same thing here, right? I mean,
so that sounds very much like relying on personal resilience.
Absolutely, it is.
As an organization, do you develop any approaches that actually allows a kind of systematic or systems approach to resilience to support those teams?
Absolutely. These teams were supported both from I say physical, but we were working way too many hours at the hours of the morning, but psychological help was there because obviously you are dealing with your friends. I will tell you, though, that the culture of NASA had changed. Once these accidents happened, Challenger and Columbia, less so with Challenger, but Columbia, the whole culture of the agency had changed because we had made a very big mistake. Right? From the top management level down, we had made a very big mistake. And we realized that. And your culture changes. If you can do one of two things. You can either roll over in your shell and put your head and say, not my fault, I'll wait until we fly again. Or you can do something about it. And you can say, how do I avoid this happening again? Do I improve the processes that I developed? Do I take even more pride in the hardware that I built? Do I train these people as if they were my parents or my son or my brother? And I think that feeling came forward after Columbia, which is, listen, I don't want you going through this again. So we're going to make things as best we can and as safe as we can possibly make it. But in the long term, it's not safe. Just want to remember, this is not a safe environment for people to be in. Other questions? All right. Wait for the microphone, if you would, so the people on the line can hear you.
The recommendations that you put up were very much around engineering and technology recommendations, and you've just mentioned culture change. Were there any other recommendations? It's kind of a two-part question. Were there any other recommendations that were more systemic or organizational?
Yes.
And also, how do you sustain that change?
Can I take I was going to take the second part. It takes an immense effort to sustain a change of culture. Immense. And we didn't do it. I can tell you, we did not do it. After the Challenger accident, I would tell you that our culture changed immediately. But as we started flying again, and as we started getting successful again, we became complacent. So our culture basically reverted back to what it was. And it's a scary chart that I put together, which I didn't show here. But once you get down to a threshold, the likelihood that you're going to have another accident becomes much, much higher. And boom, that's when Columbia happened. And now your culture changes again, right? And you can go along this sawtooth path, unless you can break that chain and say, how do I maintain that level of culture change so that I don't fall back into my old ways? And that is the most difficult thing to do. I think by reinforcement over and over and over again that the people's lives are literally in your hands, right? The decisions you make today affect whether your friend is coming home tomorrow or your patient is coming home tomorrow or your astronaut friend that essentially puts their entire faith in what you do. That's important. And if you can maintain that level of culture, let me go to the first part of that question. Most of our astronauts, certainly in the beginning, came from the military. They were jet pilots who flew high-performance aircraft. And essentially, they would fly these jets into the ground almost, right? And they would eject at the last minute. They would fight that jet aircraft all the way down to the ground. Our shuttle pilots, who were a lot of those same people, had that same philosophy. They would fight the shuttle, and especially in the case of Columbia, we know they did. We have evidence they did. Even though there was no possible way they could have survived that accident. But they fought that vehicle all the way down. So making them transition from the normal operations to emergency operations to survival operations was key. So we now split it up into those three. Nominal, off-nominal, and crew survival. Does that answer your question? Sir, wait for the microphone if you would.
how do you cope and reassure someone like Senator John Glenn when he flew as a senator in the age of his 70s on the shuttle? After the flight, he said, as my shuttle cleared the tower, a thought kept recurring to me that every part of this shuttle has been built by a contractor who submitted the lowest possible quote.
Actually, that quote has been attributed to many people. Alan Shepard was the first one I think it was attributed to. I don't know how to answer the question. As in life, I would tell you that happens in many government agencies, right? The lowest bid wins. Is that the right way to do it? I would say no. But we ingrain, we're going back to culture for a second, we try and instill the same quality concept into the people that win those contracts. And we hold them to our standards, right? And because the contract that we sign with them has, these are the things that you are going to do. So they may be the lowest bidder on that contract, but they still have to meet the requirements we told them they had to meet. Otherwise, we'd never have selected them. It's not as if Marks and Spencers could bid on the shuttle contract. Well, they could try, but I don't think they'd be able to bring forward the expertise that's necessary to do the job. So I think we still get some very, very good offers, and we select the best of the best. Other questions? One over here.
Nigel, thank you for very good insight. The root cause of the problem was that foam which hit. And you said, well, we made a mistake. Did it mean that you had a very high risk appetite or the pressure of making it successful overridden the very wise people who were sitting over there and thinking that they can do things better?
So the size of the piece of the shuttle was about the same size as your back. The size of the foam that came off and hit the shuttle was the size of maybe a backpack or a small suitcase. No one could believe, even the highest engineers in our agency, could have believed that a piece of foam could have taken out a behemoth of a shuttle, right? But then you look at the basic physics, and I'm sure most of you had to go take high school physics. Most of you went through medical school, also a lot of you did, so you had to pass your physics over in A-levels, which I didn't. That's another story. I hated physics. But if you remember, kinetic energy is 1/2 mv², right? So at 81.7 seconds into the flight, when that foam liberated from the shuttle, it immediately decelerated, right? So it was immediately decelerating, let's say, from 1,000 kilometers an hour down to 900 kilometers an hour. The shuttle at the same time is accelerating the other way at maybe 5,000 kilometers an hour per hour. It's an acceleration, right? So at the instant of the hit, the delta velocity between the two was enormous. And if you remember, 1/2 mv². So this mass doesn't have to be very large in order for that kinetic energy to go through the roof, right? So if you look at it from the bare facts alone, foam shouldn't create a hole in the front of the shuttle, right? But we've seen foam come off the vehicle before, and it had hit the belly of the shuttle, like where the tiles are. Those tiles are much more resilient to a foam hit. We took gouges out of the tile, yes, but those were replaced each flight, and we flew the next time around. And we had seen debris hits on those tiles every flight. We called them in family, right? That doesn't mean that we kept them behind closed doors. We didn't talk about it. It means that the damage that we had seen was within the history that we'd seen before. They called it in family. Well, the difference is the leading edge of the shuttle's wings were covered in a different material called reinforced carbon-carbon, which is a much more fragile, very, very heat-rejecting material, high heat-rejecting material. That's why it's on the leading edge of the wing. But it's much more fragile. So if you hit it with a hammer, it will crack and it will break. So we based our analysis, the management team based their analysis on, well, it hit this tile, right? So the leading edge of the wing material doesn't matter. It'll be the same. We'll be fine. We'll repair after the flight and we'll fly again. When they actually did testing on the ground at Southwest Research Institute in San Antonio, Texas. They modeled how big this piece of foam was and the energies that it was going to be shot at a model of the wing. And I can tell you that every single manager, every single engineer, their jaws dropped when that cannon let loose that piece of foam and a hole in the wing that size showed up. No one could ever imagine that that piece of foam could have done that, but the basic physics tells you it did. So we failed in that particular respect. But we also failed in communication. We failed in communicating the risk. People say, well, you couldn't have got the space station, so what could you have done? Well, we're NASA, right? If you'd have told us on the second day of the mission, you had a big hole in the wing, this crew isn't coming home, I can guarantee you we would have done everything we could possibly have done, all hands on deck, to launch a rescue shuttle. We'd have figured out how to do it in the 16 days that were up there, or extend the mission as long as we possibly could, and we would have brought them home. So people telling me nothing you could have done about it, I use a very rude word, and I will not, because we have kids here, we could absolutely have brought them home. Had we known about it, had we known the extent of the damage.
I wanted to get any questions on the WebEx, Jennifer.
Thanks, Anne. So we've got the WebEx, the chat box. I have never seen it so busy on QI Connect, and it's always mega busy on QI Connect. And so just, I'm conscious of time, but just a couple, so a comment from Fiona Needleman. She said, very powerful message about the importance of ensuring that there is enough time made available for investigating properly. I'm sure the families were comforted by the care and attention given by the investigation. So that's the comment. And then I'm going to give the final question of the night over to our QI Connect Chair and Medical Director, Dr. Brian Robson. So he said, firstly, amazing and sensitive presentation. We are using safety climate survey tools to assess the appreciation of safety cultures across GP practices, hospitals, pharmacies, etc. How does NASA measure safety culture, and do they use such tools to help with the conversations?
We have, and please tell Brian to get well soon. I'm sure you hope he'll get well soon. You want him back at work, but please tell him to stay in bed because he needs to stay there. You guys are the worst patients, by the way. I'm just going to tell you that. I will tell you that the way we measure how effective our changing culture is we ask, right? And surveys are one thing that you can use. I hate surveys in some scenarios, but sometimes it's the best way to do it. But we ask our employees, do you feel that if you raise an issue of safety that it will be heard? We ask during high-level meetings that we tell them, I'm about to make a decision. I want to make certain that if there's someone, anyone in this room, whether it's, let me take the equivalent to the medical profession, whether it's a graduate of medical school, first-year resident, or a consultant, there's anyone in this room that has a different opinion of whether this decision is right or not, we need to know about it now. So they actively solicit what we call dissenting opinion at the beginning of the mission, the beginning of the meeting, and again at the end, where they say, hey, we've just made a decision. I told you at the beginning that if you have a problem with that decision, it is your responsibility to speak up. Not now, I mean, it's not outside in the corridor 5 minutes after the meeting has ended, where you always go, right, and you see these people saying, that's absolutely the wrong decision. Not the place to have that discussion. The place is in there where the decision is being made so that the decision maker can make the right decision, an informed decision. So I hope that answers Brian's question. And again, I thank you for all your attention this evening. I know I have some presentations to make, right? As do you? Okay, can't be big. Don't forget I've only got carry-on luggage. But I can't tell you what I would have done without Jennifer this week. Okay, so I'm going to get a few things. Don't trip. Please don't trip.
I almost feel that we should clap Jennifer down the stairs here. But
their jobs can vanish.
Are we starting, which way are we going first?
Before we do that, can I just echo the thanks and appreciation to Nigel and everything you gave in terms of that presentation this evening. It was absolutely awe-inspiring, and I think in particular the point that you made, Nigel, in terms of giving meaning to that sacrifice so that ultimately it would be learning and improvement, I think is a real indication of what was the intent behind this. And ultimately it was to remember some very much loved friends who were lost, sadly, in such a tragic set of circumstances. So what I'd like to do, though, in terms of before we do the actual presentation recognition, is also a thank you to your colleague, Dr. Tom Mashburn, and the QI Connect session that we had just last month, which again was a great demonstration of the opportunities for learning. Also, a thank you again to Olivia, and to your classmates, and to your teacher at Hamilton College. And tell me if I get this right in terms of pronouncing your teacher's name. How do you pronounce it? Okay, well, you say a big thank you to her as well in terms of... Just wanted to check you could say it right. That's fine. Excellent. And indeed, the other astronauts that have come along today are younger astronauts, and hopefully it's been an enjoyable evening for you as well. In terms of the colleagues here at the Glasgow Science Centre, Lorraine, Josh, Craig and Claire, for all your support in making this a seamless evening, and all the support in doing that. Again, to Jennifer, in terms of your hard work and effort, but also to Leanne, Joanne, Michelle, Jessica, Olivia, Sim and Stephen for all their organisation skills as well. So a big thank you. And in terms of recognition of gifts, and to present to you firstly, Nigel, is the recognition of all the time, the effort, the miles you've travelled to come here, but ultimately giving us a great and an inspiring evening. So many, many thanks.
Thank you so much, Robert. I appreciate it. Thank you.
And of course, the gift that is more valuable than that one.
The one that keeps on giving, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I thank you so much indeed. It was brilliant. It's been my honor to be here and my pleasure to be here too. And having made a lot of friends here in the middle of Scotland, but I will promise I will come back and visit you in on different occasions, hopefully as friends now. But I also extend an offer to you. If you are ever in the Houston area, please get in touch with Jennifer. She knows how to get in touch with me. I'll make sure that you get to see the pieces that the Johnson Space Center that not a lot of people get to see. So, but please, take me up on that, I mean. So is it my turn now?
No, yes. We've actually got another guest. We've got two special guests that are going to come up. So Olivia and Josh.
You were starting first, Olivia? Well, thank you so much. That's wonderful.
So this is a special little memento just from Glasgow. This is a Glasgow artist by the name of Stan Milne.
Okay.
Who specializes in quirky little pictures with sheep in them. And you'll see that in the spacewalk in that one.
I did.
You have a flock of sheep in the background.
My wife collects sheep.
Right.
Not real ones, not live ones. But she'll love this.
And then the second that George has got here,
okay,
we have the first sheep on the moon.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much, Olivia. Thank you, George. I appreciate
Thank
it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for all the young people who are here tonight. They've had such a good time here.
Well, thank you for staying, letting them stay up late, by the way. I'm sure they're past their bedtime, I'm sure. I do have a couple of things. For you that I either sent across the pond in the first place. But first, could I get a representative from the Glasgow Science Centre, if there is one, who would like to come and do it? So, again, this is a remarkable facility, and thank you for putting up with Healthcare Improvement Scotland and putting up with me taking over your stage for an hour. Sullivan. This is just a memento from us, from the Johnson Space Center. It says to the Glasgow Science Center from your friends at the NASA Johnson Space Center. So many thanks. And we have a similar one for Healthcare Improvement Scotland. So I would like that to accept, like you to accept that on their behalf. Again, from your friends at the NASA Johnson Space Center.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Couple of things that go with that that I'll give you after the presentations are complete. There's a patch from STS-107 from Columbia. This is a very unique patch, by the way. There is no other patch that is this shape. The patches are designed by the astronauts who flew the mission. So to a degree, the patch is a remembrance of them, very much heartfelt in terms of an individual message. So for you two and for Healthcare Improvement Scotland, let me give you those two as well. So there you go. Now, there is one final thing I'd like to hand out. A very special young man, a very brave young man, was adamant that he wanted to ask the first question on the last QI Connect. And I thought, okay, first of all, I asked Jennifer, I said, how old is this young man? She said, 8. I went, okay, that's a very brave thing. I certainly wouldn't have been able to go on a live show and ask a question, let at least this first question, to a NASA astronaut. So I thought, what can I do for this young man? And so Callum, do you remember I asked you a question during the QI Connect? I said, what's your favorite color? And what did you say? You said orange first. And we have the tape to prove it. And then because I knew I couldn't get orange, I said, so what's your second favorite color? I mean, then you said green. Okay. Well, the problem is, NASA doesn't do very well in orange and green. But I do have something special for you. Are you okay coming up and standing by me? Okay. Can you welcome Callum, please? So when I first got to know about you, I sent a signed photograph of my boss at the time, whose name was Bill MacArthur. Do you remember that? And when your father received it, and I think you got it for your birthday, didn't you? And you took it to class, and your father told me that your reaction was that you were gobsmacked. Well, even I know what gobsmacked is from my time. I grew up 24 years in this country, so. But I had to translate to my boss, Bill MacArthur, and tell him that gobsmacked meant that he was absolutely over the moon. So you became a very important person to me, you and your family, and you and your father, and I've met your mother and your sister, that's it. I had to get something for you, all right? Was that all right? Now, I couldn't get an orange something. I couldn't get anything green, but I had to get red. Is that all right? And I thought, well, it's red, but anyone can get a red polo shirt, right? So how about if I put the Johnson Space Center on there in the first place? So now, I don't think anyone's going to have anything like that. But then I thought, well, wait a minute. What if somebody does? So I thought it would be important to put your name on it. So, Callum, this is for you. It's got your name on it, and it's a reminder of what happened this evening. And I would like you and your family, when they do come across to the States, to come and spend some time with me. Is that all right? So this is for you, and I hope you'll wear it. And that's for you as well. That's another time. So thank you. So you have one last one, right? Top tweeter.
Who is a top
speaker? Thanks,
Peter.
Peter.
Peter's there. And the third row from the back.
Oh,
yeah. So again, handing it back. I appreciate it.
Okay, well, again, an enormous thank you to Nigel. Enormous thank you again as well to you for being here tonight, to our young astronauts. I think we've got a lot of learning from this and look forward to deploying it and taking it into our workplaces in the days and months to come. So all I can say tonight is, again, thank you and a safe journey home. Good night.